Actually, I can probably share. Thank you all for coming on. We're going to give people a few more minutes to hop on, and then we will begin. Okay, I know we have a lot of people still coming on, but we've got a really full hour for you planned. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. Good afternoon. Thank you all for tuning into the BRAD 2023 webinar. My name is Logan France, and I am the Program Director for BRAD, or Biomedical Research Awareness Day. For those of you who are new to BRAD, it is an international program committed to educating the public on the importance of biomedical research and the critical role of animals in medical advancements for both humans and animals. Institutions and organizations and individuals around the world host BRAD events to educate their own community on animal research. And we work with each of those BRAD participants to help them plan their event. We provide educational materials and giveaways, and we help them reach their target audience. BRAD is held every year on the third Thursday in April, which is today. And we are really grateful for all of our participants who take part in it. It has become an incredible event that really gives a lot of recognition to the people and the animals who make a big difference in our lives every day. And we have a unique setup this year, which I'm super excited about. So in addition to what will be a fantastic webinar by Dr. Roth, we are going to have a live look at real live rats in research, including a rat tickling demo. So before we begin, there are a few things I want to mention. Go over here. Okay, the webinar is being recorded, and you will be able to access the recording using the same link you used to register and to sign on today. And it should be available after 4 p.m. today. So again, you must register and put in your information in order to access the recording. We are going to have a Q&A session following the presentation, and you can ask questions of the rat tickling crew and also of Dr. Roth. So please do type your questions into the Q&A throughout the presentation, and we'll get to them at the end. If you don't already, please find and follow us on social media, scan those QR codes, depending on which platform is your choice. We share lots of great educational information. We have photos of BRAD events, articles about animal research, so please do follow us. And then you can also check out our website at bradglobal.org. We have a ton of resources and pictures of events and things that can help you get creative in your own outreach efforts. I want to take a moment to thank our sponsors that make BRAD possible. Each year, we're able to expand the program. We develop new materials, provide participants with boxes of materials that they can use at their event. And this truly is made possible by our sponsorships and their generous support. So thank you to all of our sponsors, and especially our platinum level sponsors, Technoplast and the American College of Neuropsychopharmacology. And once again, Technoplast is the official sponsor of the BRAD webinar this year, which we're very grateful for. And Technoplast has more than 70 years of experience in the design, manufacturing, and distribution of specialized housing products related to equipment and laboratory animal industry. So conventional and ventilated rodent caging systems, changing stations, aquatic holding systems, washing equipment, and more. If you're in the field, you've certainly heard their name and you likely use their equipment. The company's North American headquarters, where all facets of the business and a large part of manufacturing operations are internally handled, is located in Westchester, Pennsylvania, and they are actually hosting their very own Broad event today, which is awesome. The Technoplast staff consists of a network of specialists and consultants in planning, designing, and constructing new and existing Vivaria. So reach out to Technoplast or existing Technoplast clients for more information and experience with their equipment. If you don't already, be sure to follow them on social media. Here are their different handles and ways to get in touch with them. And we have had the pleasure of collaborating with Technoplast since Brad was really started in its infancy. And every year we find new ways to work together and expand educational resources that we then are able to make available to all of you, our Brad participants. We did a contest last year and got tons of votes to determine which species would be highlighted in our Crazy Creatures poster series sponsored by Technoplast. And these were our winners. And we're excited to see all of these posters hanging up in your facilities. If you ordered a Brad box and you are participating in Brad, you have these posters. So thank you, Technoplast, for all that you do to support Brad and the research community. And I hope you're having an awesome event yourself. Again, if anyone is interested in becoming a sponsor, please do reach out. You can get in touch with us via our website, bradglobal.org, or through email, brad@amprogress.org. Okay, well, let's get started. So we will begin the first portion of our webinar, which is brought to us by Megan Gearhart, Senior Manager for Laboratory Animal Resources at Alexion Pharmaceuticals, AstraZeneca's Rare Disease Unit. And she's going to be live streaming rats in their vivarium, highlighting the importance of quality care and enrichment, as well as mentioned, a rat tickling demo. So she is joined by team members Kara Greatsinger, technician and certified rat tickler, and Heather Wiles, technologist and colony management lead. So I will turn it over to them and you can take it away, Megan.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us in the Alexion Vivarium. We're really excited to have you. As you can see, our rats are also really excited. We think it's really important to tell you a little bit about rats in the research setting before we give you a demonstration on rat tickling. Enrichment in lab animal settings is really vital to the success of animal research. Happy and healthy animals are what bring new medicines to people in need every day. And research has shown that enrichment in animals, otherwise known as toys, improves the quality of life for our animals, it reduces the stress, and it helps improve their psychological well-being. So why wouldn't you want to make sure that your animals have as much fun as possible? We don't know, because our animals do have a lot of fun. They actually get a rotation of toys, and those toys get changed weekly. They have no less than two toys in their cage. And you can see it's a little hard to see in there right now, but I wanted to let you see what we do use so you know they can have paper to shred. They can have cotton to shred. They have little sticks that they chew. Some of them are artists with them. They have nylons, just like you would have for a puppy, or they have these barbells that are very similar to also dog toys. They have tunnels and balls that they can run through. Sometimes the tunnels get suspended in the cage and they can swing on them. And then they have these cups, handles. And the hut they like to sleep underneath. All of these are a color that blocks light for the rats so that they rest. Because truthfully, right now is their nap time. They like to play at night. Other forms of enrichment can be things like treats, and they can be physical enrichment. And the physical enrichment is where tickling comes in. Tickling mimics natural play in rats, just like you see with puppies. They have this rough and tumble play. They'll grab each other by the back of the neck. They'll flip each other over, and they'll chase each other around the cage. With puppies, when you watch that happen, you know they're having fun because you can hear their noises. With rats, you can't hear their noises to the human ear. So you can see that it looks fun, but it could also look too rough if you didn't know any differently. So our friends at Turner Scientific have created this monitor for use to hear vocalizations in rats. And this monitor, when the rats are happy and excited, you will see green flashes. And I will show you that when we move forward. Gotta be back. Navigate back. I'm going to be quiet now and try and get a really good view of Tara, our certified rat tickler. She's putting in the monitor, the microphone for the monitor in the cage. And she's going to tell you what tickling is and show you what it looks like.
So as Megan mentioned, we're going to replicate how rats play with each other. There's three steps to rat tickling. The first is you'll kind of tickle down on the back of the neck. They get pretty excited. Pick them up, flip them, pin them, and tickle them. And as you can see, they'll run around pretty excited. These guys like to chase my hand and nibble on it, and you'll see they'll start to play with each other. Looking at the monitor, if they're making positive vocalizations, you know that they're enjoying it. You can see they're pretty happy, and if I had to pick them up and I needed to do something with them, they're happy about being in my hand because they see my hand does something positive and they know something good is coming.
They both want to be in your hand. So I'm going to step over to the monitor while Kara plays and see if you can't see some happy noises. The red and green splashes are all the noises that we can't hear. See all that green? All of that is rat giggling. So rat tickling is not just positive for the animals, but it also creates a bond between the handlers and the animals. As you can see, I mean, they want to come over and visit with everyone. And that's because at a very, very young age, we start all of our tickling before we start any other work that these animals will do. And as Kara mentioned, that means that when they see us as positive, and it makes for a very enjoyable work environment for both our animals and our technicians. And now our rats can't wait to hear what Tanya has to talk about today.
Thank you so much. Okay, let me get back to my screen here and share with you all. Whoops. One second. We very much appreciate you giving us an inside look into the vivarium. And we are next going to, I'm going to give you a little bit of information about the next part of our webinar. So Dr. Roth is going to be speaking with us today about her research, and she is a professor and chair of the Department of Psychological and Brain Sciences at the University of Delaware. Dr. Roth received her Bachelor of Science degree in biology from Roanoke College and completed her doctoral degree at the University of Oklahoma. Dr. Roth has received numerous honors and awards for scholarship, including a Young Investigator Award from the Brain and Behavior Research Foundation, the 2010 Ziskind Sommerfeld Award from the Society of Biological Psychiatry, an Early Career Impact Award from the Federation of Associations in Behavioral and Brain Sciences, and was elected a Kavli Fellow of the National Academy of Sciences and Fellow of the Eastern Psychological Association. Very accomplished. Her primary research interests center on identifying epigenetic changes associated with early life caregiving experiences and understanding their causal role in behavioral outcome. So with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Roth.
Okay, thank you, Logan, so much. Hopefully folks can hear me. And then let me try to share my screen. Okay, can folks see my screen?
Yes.
Great. Okay, well, good afternoon, everybody. I'm super excited to have this opportunity to talk to you today. So I want to begin with thanking Paula and Logan for the invite to do this. So in our lab, we are interested in understanding how adversity encountered early in development can get under the skin to have consequences for behavior. We know, unfortunately, many children experience traumatic and stressful experiences, and we want to know how those experiences affect their brains and behavior so that we can help identify treatments and policies that help them lead healthy lives. To do this, it's necessary to understand the biological root cause of behavioral and mental outcomes associated with adversity experienced early in life. One of the challenges we face in understanding trajectories responsible for behavioral outcomes and mental health following stressful and traumatic early life experiences is untangling the complex relationship between nature and nurture. Although extensive data from a variety of disciplines have long provided evidence for an interaction between our genes and environmental factors, such as those listed here, we are still working to understand the biological mechanisms that would allow this. As you all probably know, a particularly vulnerable time period for this gene-environment interplay is early development, and especially in the context of caregiver experiences. And it's clear that experiences with a caregiver remain pervasive across the lifespan. Clinical research and work from animal models that I've summarized here well complement one another in highlighting the importance of a nurturing caregiving environment. If we take child abuse or disruptions in maternal care in rodents by way of example, we know that these experiences alter adolescent and adult social behavior, produce deficits in cognition, and increase the likelihood of emotional and mental dysfunction. Furthermore, we know that the behavioral impact is often not limited to the generation that directly experienced the mistreatment, but can reach into additional generations, where you might see, for example, learning and memory deficits, the perpetuation of abusive caregiving, and the prevalence of psychiatric disorders in first, second, and even third generation offspring. Brain imaging studies on adults with a history of child abuse and neglect, they testify to the lasting impact of a disrupted caregiving environment on the structure of and the functional capacity of the brain, particularly in regions such as the prefrontal cortex, the amygdala, and the hippocampus. Rodent non-human primate models of disrupted caregiving environments likewise demonstrate these lasting brain effects, and they've been especially instrumental in helping us define the damage down to the levels of cells and molecules. So for example, research from many labs tell us that the structure of brain cells and the activity level of genes are directly related to the quality of early life experiences. So it's clear that early experiences can somehow be etched into the brain in a way that they can influence brain function and behavioral output for an individual. In the mid-2000s, evidence began emerging that biological mechanisms capable of perpetuating memories at that cellular level, and that can physically mediate that interplay between genes and the environment, play a significant role in experience-induced brain changes and behavioral outcomes, including those related to early life experiences. And these type of mechanisms fall under this growing umbrella that we call epigenetics. So broadly defined, epigenetics refers to the study of changes in gene activity that do not involve any alterations in that underlying DNA code itself. And in its strictest sense, epigenetics refers to chemical modifications to DNA and its associated proteins that help regulate the activity of your genes. In your cells, including those in your brain, DNA is condensed and wrapped around proteins that are called histones, much like thread on a spool. And that complex is called chromatin. Now, if your DNA is tightly wrapped around those histone proteins, or if you think about the thread here being tightly wrapped around the spool, then genes tend to be turned off because machinery that needs to gain access to the DNA to turn it on just can't do that. On the other hand, if that structure is a lot more relaxed or that thread is not tightly wrapped around the spool, that same machinery can easily access DNA and turn on a gene. Now, whether that packaging is tight or relaxed, that's influenced by chemical tags that attach to those histone proteins or to the DNA itself. So we're going to focus on DNA today. So I want you to focus on this bottom panel here. So here I'm depicting a portion of DNA for a given gene. Okay, if you remember, our DNA is composed of building blocks called nucleotides. And examples of these building blocks are cytosines that I'm designating here with the letter C and guanines that I'm designating here as the letter G. Okay, and in regards to DNA, the addition of methyl groups, shown here in those little yellow M's, okay, to cytosines, a process that we call DNA methylation, is most often associated with that compact chromatin structure and inactive genes. Some of the first empirical support for epigenetics and behavior came from developmental studies in rats. And studies since, utilizing candidate gene and really complicated whole genome approaches with various rodent models, have consistently indicated a causal or a direct relationship between the quality of the caregiving environments and epigenetic modifications within the developing and adult brain. So here, for example, Michael Meany's and Moshe Zipf's pioneering work showed us that methylation of DNA associated with the glucocorticoid receptor gene, okay, that's a gene in our hippocampus that underlies our ability to respond to and handle stress, is directly associated with a type of caregiving experienced during the first postnatal week. So specifically, rats raised by mothers that displayed high levels of nurturing caregiving behaviors, which for a rat is a lot of licking and grooming, they grow up to show much lower levels of methylation of that gene, and that's associated with less fear and reduced levels of anxiety-like behavior. And then the opposite is true of adult offspring that have been raised by a more non-nurturing mother. Those rats, they show much higher levels of methylation of that same gene, and in turn, they have more anxiety-like and fear-related behaviors. Changes in DNA methylation continue to be explored as pathways through which disruptions in caregiving environments and early adversity might affect brain and behavioral development. And indeed, relationships between epigenetic modifications and adversity experienced in the context of caregiving are detectable in both children and adults. So for example, suicide victims with a history of child abuse, they have a lot of methylation of that GR gene in their hippocampus, so that same gene we just talked about in the rats, and in those individuals that coincides with less expression of the gene. And then utilizing DNA methylation measures from accessible cells in living humans, such as those in blood or saliva, investigators have linked methylation alterations of many genes with exposure to maltreatment, the experience of institutionalized care, and even low socioeconomic status and parental stress levels. Now, given the design of most human studies, it's real difficult to know if any of these changes are really caused by those specific early life events, or perhaps are also or instead attributable to other life events or even prenatal environments. And it's difficult to know how those changes causally or directly relate to any behavioral outcomes. So non-human animal models are particularly important for exploring causality between experimentally controlled postnatal environments, epigenetic changes, and behavioral outcomes, something that just isn't feasible to do in humans. Sorry, got a little too fast there. So in our research program, rodents are helping us better understand the capacities of disruptions in caregiving behavior to cause epigenetic modifications in the brain of offspring, and to understand what these modifications mean for their later development and behavior. Let's see if I can make these videos play. You guys probably aren't seeing these play. I'm not seeing these play. Oh, here we go. So in our lab, we produce mild stress for some rat mothers. Hopefully you can see in the video here on the left, we do this by giving them access to very few wood shavings for nest building. This is not how they normally live, and this changes their caregiving behavior as they spend a lot more time foraging, trying to build a nest. Then the video on the right approximates how they normally live, where you see, hopefully, lots of wood shavings. And as you can see in this example, they're readily able to make a nest, and in turn, they settle down and focus on caregiving behaviors. We produce these mild stress experimental conditions for 30 minutes per day for the first 7 days of a rat's life. And then the rest of the rat's life is spent experiencing normal parental care, playing with toys and other rats with free access to food and water, all of course while under licensed veterinary care and supervision. And then as the rat grows up, we're able to observe changes in the brain and behavior tied to those specific early life experiences. Okay, so if you summarize the caregiving behaviors that our moms display, you will see that under normal conditions, here on the right, they spend a lot of their time displaying nurturing behaviors, which for a rat mom is a lot of pup licking and grooming, as well as her crouching over and nursing those pups. And then under our mild stress conditions, moms spend less time doing those behaviors. And instead, what happens is we potentiate some other non-nurturing behaviors, which do occur naturally, and you can see those here. And these non-nurturing behaviors that we potentiate include things like mishandling of the pups and actively avoiding the pups while she's out and about foraging. So to understand the capacity of these types of experiences to epigenetically modify the brain, we've been using a developmental approach. And we look at these epigenetic modifications induced by these experimental conditions across three developmental stages. But in the interest of time today, I'm really going to mostly talk about data from our adult time point. And our adult time point is a 90-day-old rat. In addition, we've taken what's called a targeted gene approach in many of the studies I'm going to describe, focusing on what's called the brain-derived neurotrophic factor gene, or BDNF for short, for many reasons, several that I've summarized here. So for example, we know that this gene plays such an important role in the development and survival of our brain cells, as well as their responsiveness that's necessary for cognition throughout the lifespan. Furthermore, we know that several psychiatric disorders that are often associated with traumatic and stressful early life environments, such as depression, bipolar disorder, PTSD, they've been linked to changes in methylation of this particular gene. Now, of course, we'd never predict that BDNF is the only gene affected by disruptions in caregiving, or the only gene involved in behavioral outcomes associated with disruptions in caregiving. But it's a great locus for us to use some of the most sensitive techniques to ask some really targeted experimental questions. So in some of our earliest work, we simply asked whether our adult animals, again, that 90-day-old time point. If they have different patterns of DNA methylation based upon the type of caregiving experiences they had as infants. And so these are data here for an important regulatory region of the BDNF gene that's really necessary for its activity in the brain. And remember these letters, these just represent those building blocks that form that basic structural unit of DNA. And then for the study, we focus on the prefrontal cortex. And what we find is that rats that only experience nurturing care, we find very little DNA methylation for that particular region of the gene. While in contrast, our rats that experience the mild stress and disrupted caregiving conditions recreated, we see much higher levels of DNA methylation, which I'm showing here with the pink M's here. And then consistent with the idea that these epigenetic marks are capable of changing gene activity, we do find significantly less activity of that gene in these rats. Some incredible graduate and undergraduate students working in the lab over the years have looked to see if there are methylation alterations in other brain regions we know are profoundly affected by early life experiences. Their projects have generated lots of data, and don't worry, I'm not gonna take the time to walk you through all that in any detail. But the punchline of the story is we do indeed find that disruptions in caregiving affect methylation states in other brain regions, like the hippocampus and amygdala. Again, regions we know are affected in humans with a history of child abuse or neglect. And what's kind of cool is we see that the nature of the change, whether it's an increase or decrease in DNA methylation, depends upon which brain region you're looking at. Whether you're looking at a male or a female brain, and what type of brain cell you're actually looking at. Your brain's composed of lots of different types of cells with diverse functions. And what we see is that even these brief bouts of stressful experiences in the context of caregiving that we create, they have the ability to change epigenetic states for certain cell types in cell type specific ways. And we especially see that in neurons, if you think of those as kind of the workhorse of the brain. And thinking about how a change like DNA methylation might be able to drive a change in behavior, it's plausible to think about, you know, resultant changes in gene activity that are then responsible for changes in the actual structure of the brain. And so this is some very new work in the lab. And we've been fortunate to take advantage of a small animal MRI here at UT to assess the basic structure and structural integrity of brains from rodents that have experienced our different caregiving environments. Like I said, this project is very new. It's very much in its early stages. But here are just some snapshots of some preliminary data from brain scans obtained from adolescent animals that experienced either our disrupted or nurturing care environments. And our adolescents for the study were between 25 and 35 days of age. So here on the left, you are seeing that animals that experienced disrupted caregiving, they have a smaller cerebellar vermis, which is a portion of the cerebellum. And that's a brain region that helps control motor skills and coordination. And then on the right, you're seeing here that animals that experienced disrupted caregiving have a reduction in a measure that tells us something about the structural integrity of the medial prefrontal cortex. And that's a brain region that's involved in lots of things, but things like social cognition, decision-making, and long-term memory. So these findings are particularly exciting to us as they nicely complement what you find in the human literature, where you often see decreased cerebellar volumes, you see lower prefrontal cortex connectivity in children and adolescents with a history of maltreatment. There's a lot more to do on this project, including scanning animals also in adulthood to better understand the trajectory of those changes and what they mean, as well as seeing if maybe a behavioral intervention, something like exercise, can mitigate any of the epigenetic as well as the structural changes. Okay, so in addition to long-term epigenetic consequences from disruptions in caregiving, We also find some long-term behavioral consequences. And one of the first ones we found this for was for maternal behavior. So not only do females grow up to appear more anxious-like several days prior to giving birth, where you see they have lots of self-grooming, as well as rearing and wall-climbing behavior in the home cage, the females then show the same types of altered caregiving behaviors toward their own offspring that they had received as infants in our experimental conditions. So specifically when looking at the interactions with their infants, we see moms displaying less of those nurturing behaviors, so less publicing and grooming and nursing. And instead we see a lot more mishandling and avoidance of their own pups. And you know, this is a very nice parallel to what you see in humans exposed to early adversity, where there is often a perpetuation of negative parenting across generations. Because of that observation of altered maternal behavior, we've also explored whether there are any epigenetic consequences for those offspring. And indeed, we find that 8-day-old offspring derived from those females who had experienced our disruptive caregiving environments, they have a lot of methylation of that same gene in their prefrontal cortex and hippocampus. We've also explored whether there are behavioral changes with a very controlled and specific task that assess depressive-like or coping behaviors, anxiety-like behaviors, and learning and memory. Just going to point out one of these. So for example, we use what's called a novel object recognition task. That is based on a rat's natural tendency to spend more time exploring a novel object than a familiar one. So just like kids, rats like the shiny new toy. And we find that our females spend significantly less time investigating a new object on day two of the test. And that tells us that they have a deficit in recognition memory. Now, a lot of our recent and current work in the lab has been geared at trying to begin to address what the methylation changes mean for behavior outcomes. And one way we have done that is to pharmacologically alter DNA methylation and then see if we can mitigate or rescue aberrant behavioral outcomes. The punchline there is we've had some success with that approach, and those data are helping us demonstrate some causality between the epigenetic changes and gene deficits, and in turn, the behavioral impact. But also, very importantly, those data help us see that DNA methylation and gene expression patterns linked to early life experiences are reversible, at least with drugs, the drugs we've tried. And a lot of these drugs are something they use in cancer research and for cancer treatments. So we are currently exploring whether a behavioral intervention like exercise can do the same. And rodents love to run and exercise, and lots of previous research has shown that exercise can help repair the effects of stress on the brain. And the final thing I wanted to share with you today is a project looking to see if we can move the epigenetic marks in children exposed to early life adversity. We would likewise predict that enhancing caregiving environments could potentially mitigate epigenetic consequences of early adversity to promote healthy behavioral outcomes. We've been very fortunate to be able to collaborate with Mary Dozier's group here at UD. She's a clinical psychologist. And began to test this idea in the context of some intervention work that she conducts with neglected and at-risk children. So Mary has developed a wonderful intervention program that improves parent-child relationships and a variety of biological and behavioral child outcomes. This intervention is called Attachment and Biobehavioral Catch-up, or ABC. And it's used to nationally and internationally to teach parents in 10 home-based sessions how to provide nurturing parental behaviors. And the intervention has been shown to improve things like child attachment, and stress dysregulation. So for this study, we recruited 23 parent-child dyads involved in child protective services. And on average, children were 14 months old at the start of the study. We had a near equal split of sex. 39% of the babies were white and 61% were Black or biracial. And then all parents in the study were biological mothers. In addition to involvement in the child welfare system, that sample also had some other risk factors that are important to think about. So mothers reported an average income below poverty level. Most mothers had a high school education or lower, and 61% of those were single mothers. So at the time of enrollment in the study, all children provided saliva for DNA analyses. Children were then randomized to receive either ABC or what's called Developmental Education for Families, or DEF. And so DEF is also a 10-session intervention delivered in the home, but the intervention content focuses on cognitive, motor, and language development and does not address parenting. So children completed a post-intervention lab visit 1 month after the last intervention session. And again, we took saliva samples from those individuals. Okay, don't panic, I'm gonna walk you through this. So with this project, we use what's called a whole genome approach. And that allows you to look at methylation differences across the genome, which can provide a lot of cool information on functional pathways associated with the epigenetic alterations across lots of genes. So first, children in the ABC and DEF groups, they had very similar methylation on average at that pre-intervention point, right? They haven't gone through anything yet, and it's from the same community sample. But what we found was that DNA methylation varied quite a bit between the ABC and DEF groups. At over 14,000 sites post-intervention. So what we did was we performed a clustering analysis on sites that displayed the same change in direction among all individuals in each group. So to orient you to what's called here a heat map, each column is a DNA sample. Okay, so each child is represented twice, right, with both a pre-intervention and a post-intervention DNA methylation measurement. And then each row represents a site in the genome where we are measuring methylation. And then the color indicates relative methylation values at those sites, where you have dark blue indicating less methylation and red indicating that site is very methylated. Okay, so this cluster here on the right, that contains all the post-intervention samples from the DEF kids clustered together with all the pre-intervention samples from both groups. Okay, and then this intensely colored cluster to the left are the post-intervention DNA measurements for children who received ABC. And again, ABC is that intervention that addresses parenting behavior. And we found that those changes map onto actually functionally relevant regions of the gene for gene activity and gene pathways that matter for things we think, like our cells being able to communicate with one another and processes responsible for our brain cells actually developing and then surviving. And then processes responsible for our cells being able to make energy. As you can imagine, these pathways may have important implications for development, both in the brain as well as the body. Lots of work needs to follow up with this, including replication studies and investigating whether these changes are long-lived and associated with any positive behavioral changes in these children. But nonetheless, these results provide preliminary evidence that enhancing parental behaviors in at-risk children can change epigenetic states. So just to summarize, we are seeing how even mild and brief disruptions in caregiving can leave their marks on DNA to influence later life behavior. You know, we're also learning in both our basic research work and our collaborative work with kids that the epigenome can be changed after adversity. And altogether, this reveals some of the mechanisms driving the development of behavior and mental health, helps us understand the brain's capacity to change because of experience, and identifies important targets for intervention work. Understanding these biological roots of behavior, again, it's critical for informing intervention work and public health policy decisions aimed at promoting healthy child development and mental health. And with that, I'll just end by thanking all the incredible graduate students and undergraduates that have worked in the lab over the years, all my awesome collaborators and our funding, and then you for your attention.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. That was a fascinating presentation, and it really is incredible what we can learn from rats and how much they can tell us. And you guys do really incredible work. And we've gotten a number of questions already. So we are going to move into the Q&A session. If you have other questions, please type them into the Q&A. I know we've had a few that were answered already via typed message, but we're going to go ahead and talk about some of those too. So I'm just going to go down the list. One comment here, it is really great to attend a presentation regarding epigenetics. I've only found good information on epigenetics in watching Bruce Lipton presentations on Gaia Channel. So good, glad. We often struggle with the enrichment we can offer with our cranially implanted rats. Heterospecific play and shelters are generally not an option. Would you have any suggestions besides nesting and gnawing materials that could be utilized? And again, we have our crew from AstraZeneca or Alexion there, hey, that are available to answer questions as well. So whenever it's directed towards you, you can just unmute yourself and speak up.
Sure, we can answer that. We don't actually have that model in-house, so it's not something I know about, but I will say that our friends at BioServe are really good about knowing animal models and what's safe for each type of surgical cannulation. So I'd reach out to them directly and ask them for something that they could use.
Excellent. Okay, do the F1 females showing disruptive caregiving change their behavior litter after litter?
Oh, that's a great question and something we've never been able to address yet. I just need a grad student that wants to stay for a while and do those like long-term, you know, developmental multi-generation studies. And then, you know, unfortunately, we've had a lot of construction and like building woes at UD. So we just literally have never been able to answer that. It's a fantastic question and something I'd certainly love to do at some point.
Okay, another question for you, Dr. Roth. Does exercise help mitigate the harmful impacts of adversity?
Yeah, you know, there's certainly some evidence in the literature that, you know, if we just think of stress as adversity, that exercise does lots of great things to reduce like structural changes and changes to genes and certainly changes to behavior. In terms of adversity that we're doing, I would say stay tuned. And one of my grad students is currently looking to see if that does something. I have a colleague that's done some fetal alcohol syndrome research where exercise in her model can certainly do some really positive things to the brain and behavior of those rats. So we're very much inspired by that work and trying to see if that will happen in our rodents.
Awesome. Okay. Do you have any data to support how long it may take to reverse the effects of maltreatment on DNA?
So the data we have so far, let me think about this. So we, like I said, I mentioned some drug studies where we use some drugs that are being used in cancer research and treatment to go in and try to change things. We didn't do a time course study. What we did was we did a 7-day treatment with the drug. So, you know, just gave them an infusion each day for 7 days and then looked to see if we could change the methylation. And, you know, that 7-day regimen was very successful a changing methylation. Now that said, I don't know how many days you would need of that to actually create that change, right? So we didn't try like one day of the drug and then look at methylation or 2 days, right? You know, there's a lot of literature that shows that you can get very quick responses with DNA methylation based upon whatever you're trying to do, like measure, like maybe a neuronal response. So I think you relatively quickly can change the methylation states after adversity. That's my quick, not a lot of data answer. How's that?
It's great. What samples were collected to do the genetic profile or evaluate the marks on DNA?
Say that again.
What samples were collected to do the genetic profile or evaluate the marks on DNA?
So for the rats, we collected brain tissue, right? We looked at various, parts of the brain to do our DNA methylation analyses. And then in the kid study, we took saliva samples. So just had kids spit, right? Spit in tubes. And we did the analyses on the spit.
Very cool. Okay, we've got one for our Alexion crew. How does one become a certified rat tickler?
So there is a course through Purdue University. I don't know the name of the link off the top of my head, but if you typed it into Google, it will come up as an NC3R site, and the link to the Purdue online certification is there. And it's free.
Yep. Awesome. We need more certified rat ticklers out there. So how many sessions of rat tickling do you do with pups and adults a week? And do you do it every day?
So it's recommended through the training that rat tickling can be used as acclimation. So if your facility's protocol allows for it, you can start as soon as they come in. It's better to start in juveniles. And they say that it takes about 3 days to know if they're responding positively to rat tickling. And you start out the first couple of days by just a couple seconds once a day and see how they like it.
Awesome. Comment and question. These cages are awesome. The ones that were viewed with the rats, which they are. What are they? Where can I get them? These are Technoplast cages. So I will actually type in, you can reach out to Ian at Technoplast, but I'll type the email address into the Q&A for that question so you can see it. But it's EMANGUM at technoplastusa.com if you have any interest in these cages. So thank you. Okay. We've got lots of questions here. Thank you, Dr. Roth. Fascinating work. Any plans to work with adults, thinking of veterans or individuals with PTSD? Any analysis of methylation groups in their brain?
You know, I would certainly love to do that. Like back in the day, I've done some rodent model PTSD work looking at methylation and some of the stressful conditions where we try to approximate, you know, what's traumatic and might be equivalent to PTSD in a rat. We certainly see a lot of the same, methylation changes. I know there's a lot of beautiful work being done by other investigators that look in patients that have been diagnosed with PTSD, and they certainly see methylation changes across the genome in those individuals.
Very good. A question about accessing the webinar. Yes, it will be available in the future. It's through the Brad website, or you can use the link that you used to get to the webinar today. People do have to register, but we will have it posted by this afternoon at 4 p.m. Okay, another question. Is there research going on or scheduled for children with sustained trauma over years? And is there something that could help reverse CPTSD beyond therapy?
You know, I'm certain there probably is that research going on. You know, I will say with Mary's work, they are following these kids from like infancy through now. I think they're some of these folks they study, they're at the adolescent age. So I certainly know Mary is doing very long-term work and trying to think about, behavior outcomes and what it all means.
Yeah. Did you utilize primates for the research or just rodents?
Just rodents. I would love to use non-human primates, but unfortunately we just don't have the facilities to do that here at UD. But that would be just freaking awesome to do that.
Yeah. Excellent. Do the 10-month-olds in the caregiving trial show any positive behavioral developmental changes as a result of the ABC program?
Yeah, so Mary has shown that, you know, for example, thinking about attachment behavior to a caregiver, which is usually disrupted in, you know, children that have experienced neglect or, you know, just a lot of parent stress, those children are actually attaching more to the caregiver after the intervention. I believe I remember they've done a little bit of some learning and memory assessments. I know their emotional behavior is much better. Their ability to regulate their emotions is actually much better after the intervention. And then I also know Mary has done some scanning because we also have a human magnet at UD, and they've been able to show some really cool structural changes after her ABC intervention.
Very good. Could DNA methylation explain why people with a history of CPTSD experience diagnoses like Ehlers-Danlos syndrome? Did I say that right?
I'm not sure what that syndrome is, but you know, you certainly could think about a change in methylation, you know, having something to do with a mental health outcome, also affecting, you know, other kind of health outcomes, whether it's other mental comorbidities, right? Or, you know, some kind of somatic change, right? Like heart disease and all those kinds of things.
Okay, another rat tickling question. Has the rat tickling program shown evidence of increasing rat lifespan?
I'm not sure about that. It's not something we have done any work on. I don't know. I don't know that that came up in the course either, but that is an interesting question.
That's a really good question.
Yeah. Do you have any advice for introducing tickling to older rats if not able to start at a young age?
I would say you could probably try it. If they're okay with being handled as it is and they're pretty acclimated to people, it might work, especially if they're group housed. But I'm not sure how they would respond to it if they're single housed or they're on the more fractious side.
Any data on methylation of offspring when father is abusive and the mother is nurturing?
Oh, you know, we've never tried anything like that. You know, we use Long Evans rats, and I'll just tell you that the dads are kind of deadbeats for us. They don't really do caregiving, right? So we capitalize on mom doing it all. But, you know, I know if I think about like prairie voles, where dads take care of the infants, and then actually in some fish species, I remember I've seen some research where dad's behavior totally matters for methylation. That's where I'm going with that. So if I could get the dads to, you know, do some of the aversive caregiving, I would see changes in methylation in the offspring.
Awesome. And I don't know who wants to answer this, but is it difficult to get rats to exercise?
I'm going to say no. And I see.
No. Rats they like to play.
Mm-hmm. Do the offspring also have the same behavioral issues with their own litters?
Yeah, I don't know, right? That's something I would love to let them grow up and see what they do. And we just have not been able to do that study yet.
Awesome. Okay. Do you find that rats interact with cotton nestlets at a high rate?
Yeah. I think not as much so as the mice do, but yes, they do pick at them. I don't think they're as good as nest makers as mice are, but yeah, they do enjoy them. Yeah.
And they really need things in their cage. So the more stuff they have, they go after what's there. So if it's just the nestlets, they'll pull that apart, but they probably prefer something they can move around.
Yeah. Another question for you guys. How long have you been doing tickling at your institute? Was it difficult to get approval to implement?
We've been doing tickling just about a year is when we came up with the plan to try and start using it. And no, For us, we have a very open mindset, especially when it comes to our culture of care. And this is definitely a culture of care for animals and humans.
I love that. Okay, has the disrupted caregiving, we've got just a couple, I know it's right at 1 o'clock, so let's finish these up and then we'll wrap up. So has the disrupted caregiving shown evidence of decreasing rat lifespan?
Yeah, that's something we've never looked at in our rats since, you know, the 90 day old time point is kind of our old time point. And so we've never just kept them around to see if it does that.
Yeah. Another for you, is rat social structure similar to humans? And if not, how translatable is social psychology research like this?
Absolutely. The social structure and the social behavior is very similar to humans.
Awesome. Okay. Well, we were able to capture most of these questions. I know some were already answered in the chat, and I had intended to go back and go over some of those because there were some good questions early on, but we are out of time. So I want to thank all of you for attending. Dr. Roth, thank you for a fantastic presentation. Megan, Heather, Kara, thank you all for your opening your doors, letting us into the vivarium, showing us the rats, and for all that you do for them on a daily basis to make their lives better. So, and then of course, to our sponsors, thank you, and our participants for attending today. Brad is a really special day for our community, and I'm very appreciative to be a part of it. And for all of you who participate in it, I hope you're having excellent events at your institution. If you have any questions, need help with anything, brad@amprogress.org, you'll get in touch with me and we are happy to help you. And then please do take pictures, send us photos of your events. We'll be sharing those all day on social media and as they come in. We know Brad events are hosted throughout the year. So again, thank you all for joining us today. And with that, we will wrap up and the webinar will be available, the recording via the link later today. So thank you all and have a great day. Bye.